Blog Talk Radio.
Hello, everyone. I'd like to welcome all of you back to Ohio Exopolitics. I'm your host, Mark Snyder. Our guest this evening is Frosty Wooldridge, who is a bit of a population expert and also an immigration expert. He's written a book, which I've talked about on occasion before. I think it's called America on the Brink. Frosty should be calling in to the show shortly. I've got a couple articles by Frosty that I thought I would go ahead and read a little bit of. You might find these interesting. This one is called The Perfect Storm Descending Upon America, Sociological Impact. By Frosty Wooldridge. And part one says, Immigration Onslaught. Part two, The Sociological Impact of Jamming Cultures Together. Part three, The Environmental Impact. Part four, What You Must Do. Frosty says the author, Samuel P. Huntington, wrote a book called The Clash of Civilizations. And author Samuel P. Huntington said, it is my hypothesis that the fundamental source of conflict in this new world will not be primarily ideological or primarily economic. The great divisions among humankind and the dominating source of conflict will be cultural. Nation states will retain the most powerful actors in world affairs, but the principal conflicts of global politics will occur between nations and different groups of different civilizations inside those nation states. The clash of civilizations will dominate global politics. The fault lines between civilizations will be the battle lines of the future. As an American living in a high-speed, high-technological society, how would you respond when all of a sudden someone flies you out of your home, transports you into an African village in Sudan or Somalia? What if a plane lifted you out of Chicago, Illinois, and transported you to Calcutta, India? What would you do when you arrived? First of all, there would be no housing, no toilets, no safe food, no clean water, no jobs, no familiarity with a radically different culture, and no ability to speak the language. No matter how smart, old, or skilled, you would not recover from the shock of being injected into a third world society. You would huddle with your own until rescued. But if not rescued, you would live in oblivion. Now, this is kind of the state that many immigrants are in the United States right now. They've been jammed into a culture they know nothing about. And they are fish out of water, and they're struggling very much to survive. And I think Frosty has some very, very good points here. And immigration is part of our downfall when it comes to overpopulation. And I am going to look for a clip here for us on overpopulation and see if I can't find out what happened to my guest. Let's listen to Human Population Growth, a Crash Course in Ecology.
If being alive on Earth were some kind of contest, humans, I think, would win it hands down. As population of organisms, we're the Michael Phelps of being alive, only we have like 250,000 times more gold medals. Last week, we talked about exponential growth, when a population grows at a rate proportional to the size of the population, even as that size of the population keeps increasing. Well, since around the year 1650, the human population has been undergoing probably the longest period of exponential growth of any large animal in history ever. In 1650, there were about 500 million people on the planet. By 1850, the population had doubled to 1 billion. And it doubled again just 80 years after that, and doubled again just 45 years after that. We are now well past 7 billion and counting. So think about this. Today, there are 80-year-olds who have watched the population of their species on Earth triple. So why is this happening? And how? And how long can it go on? Because it's kind of uncomfortable. Let's say you're shopping for dinner, and bear with me, we're going to relate it back to ecology in a second, but you got a lot of choices at your grocery store. You could buy 5 packs of ramen for $1, or you could buy some fancy ravioli made by Italian nuns out of organic pasta for like $20 a pound. They're both noodles, they're both food, but, you know, with the ramen, you get more, whereas with the handmade stuff, it tastes better, higher quality. What do you do? It's a perennial problem in nature and in our lives, satisfying the two competing impulses. Do I have more, or do I have the best? Quantity or quality? Tough choice. Although we're not really aware of it, all organisms make a similar choice through how they reproduce. In ecology, we size up who chooses quantity over quality by something called the R versus K selection theory. The R versus K selection theory says that some organisms will reproduce in a way that aims for huge exponential growth, while others are just content to hit the number of individuals that their habitat can support, that is, the carrying capacity, and then stay around that level. Species that reproduce in a way that leads to very fast growth are called R-selected species because R is the maximum growth rate of a population when you're talking math talk, as we learned last week. Very strongly R-selected animals make a lot of babies in their lifetime and just hope that they make it. If some of the babies get eaten or something, no biggie.
There are others where those came from.
On the other hand, K-selected species only make a few babies in their lifetime, and they invest in them very heavily. K in math language is carrying capacity, since K-selected species usually end up living at population densities closer to their carrying capacity than R-selected ones. Of course, things aren't so cut and dry in nature. Most animals aren't very strongly K-selected or R-selected. It's actually, you know, a spectrum. Some organisms, usually smallish ones, reproducing more on the R side, and others usually larger ones on the K side. Most species are somewhere in the middle. So the reason I'm telling you this is to drive home how bananas it is that humans have gotten to the population size we have. Because we tend to reproduce way on the K-selected side of the spectrum. We're pretty big mammals, usually only have a few kids during our lifetimes, and those kids are a total pain in the butt to raise, but we put a ton of resources into them anyway. So even though humans reproduce K-selected-ishly, for the past few centuries, our population growth curve has been looking suspiciously like that of an R-selected species. And exponential growth, even for our selected species, usually does not go on for 350 years. So how did this all happen? Well, the short answer is humans figured out how to raise our carrying capacity so far indefinitely, and we did this by eliminating a bunch of obstacles that would have made our numbers level off at a carrying capacity a long, long time ago. These obstacles, you will recall, are limiting factors, and we managed to blast them to pieces in a few different ways. First, we've upped our ability to feed ourselves. Our crazy rapid population growth started in Europe around the 17th century because that's when agriculture was becoming mechanized, and fancy new farming practices like the domestication of animals and crops were increasing food production. From Europe...
Okay, folks, I was able to get in touch with Frosty. Sorry about the slowdown. Now, hopefully he... Oh, there he is. I think that's him right there. Let me try to bring him on the air.
Correct.
Frosty, welcome to the show, buddy.
Thank you so much, Mark, and Happy New Year to each listener across the United States, Canada, and the world. It's exciting to be with you, and a happy 2017. I'm looking forward to this year and all of the possibilities that we as a nation might engage for 2017. I'm excited.
Excellent, excellent. Let's jump right into things here. I was telling the listeners a little bit about your articles, particularly the one on the clash of civilizations by Samuel P. Huntington. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Well, I certainly can. For those of you who would like to see this four-part series, it's called The Perfect Storm Descending Upon America. Part one is the immigration onslaught that talks about the sheer numbers of what it's going to be like for us to add 100 million immigrants from all over the world. And then, of course, part two is the sociological impact of bringing in 100 million immigrants from 190 different countries with 190 different worldviews and 190 different cultures and 190 different languages, along with endless numbers of religions. And then part three will be the environmental impact of adding all of these people. And part four is what you can do as an individual to change the course of history for your children. And so in part two, the sociological impact, as you can imagine, is going to be horrific. Samuel P. Huntington wrote a book called Clash of Civilizations. I have a copy of it and have read it actually twice. And he said in it, and I quote, "It is my hypothesis that the fundamental source of conflict in this new world will not be primarily ideological or primarily economic. The great divisions among humankind and the dominating source of conflict will be cultural. Nation states will remain the most powerful actors in world affairs. But the principal conflicts of global politics will occur between nations and groups of different civilizations, in parentheses, inside those nation states. The clash of civilizations will dominate global politics. The fault lines between civilizations will be the battle lines of the future," unquote.
Frosty, do you think that Trump will be able to stop some of this immigration?
We're going to see, I hope, and for those of you who have heard me on this show and certainly have read my work in the last 20 years, I have always been a man who appreciates, from my travels all over the planet, across six continents now, on a bicycle at 12 miles an hour, that the human race has been in trouble ever since I traveled on a bicycle through Asia and China and India and Bangladesh. And I always try to warn everybody about the population issue, about the fact that the United States added 100 million people in the last 45 years. It's about to add 138 more million people in the next 33 years. But it never seemed to dawn on anybody. And so, 15 years ago, I started writing about immigration, specifically illegal immigration. Hmm. That literally got me launched across the United States in a greater capacity. As to what Trump is going to do, it's going to be interesting, because he has said within the last week that he was going to build the wall. Number two, even his new Spicer, the secretary who's going to be, going to be taking care of all of the communications there, as the press secretary, he talked about going after sanctuary cities, now numbering over 300 sanctuary cities, where the mayor and the city councils have voted in sanctuary for illegal aliens, now numbering, in my book, America on the Brink, the next out of 100 million Americans, I saw figures around 20 million illegal aliens. Ann Coulter, who wrote the book Adios America, the left's plan for turning America into a third world hellhole, she did census uptakes on that, and she submitted a number of 31 million. So whether it's 20 million or 31 million, it's a huge number, and they're being essentially illegally covered, if you will, or given immunity from prosecution and arrest by all these sanctuary cities, and the consequences are extraordinary. Deaths of American citizens, undercutting of wages, undercutting of jobs, undercutting of the rule of law. And so he said that he's going to go after these sanctuary cities because they are in violation of federal law. And so It's going to be interesting whether or not he's going to either take away funds or have the Attorney General, which would probably be Jeff Sessions, to go after all of these sanctuary cities. So that really is what's happening. He also has the ability, number three, to stop mass immigration from terrorist countries like Syria. And he doesn't have to say it's Muslim immigration. Just say, hey, it's Syrian refugees have the opportunity to become terrorists and be terrorists, so he can cut them out from being imported into the United States. And then number four, all he has to do, Mark, is simply enforce the laws on the books mm-hmm. across this nation internally. It's understood that each illegal alien hired by a corporation, a company like McDonald's or Chipotle's or Marriott or whatever, is a $2,000 fine per illegal and up to 5 years in prison. If he starts enforcing that law, you will see a exodus of millions of illegal aliens back to their own country, because they will have no longer the ability to sustain themselves here, because you get a couple of CEOs like from McDonald's or Marriott Hotels or right on down Chipotle's or, you know, right on down the line, they're no more CEOs want to come out in handcuffs and then be prosecuted and sit in jail time. They'll give up their cheap labor in order to stay out of jail. So those are the things that he can do, and I suspect he's going to do them. He's a pretty brash and bold and certainly outspoken man, and that's what he promised in his run-up to the presidency. So it's going to be interesting to see what happens with that.
Do you think that the people that have an open policy towards immigration, people that support all of this immigration, do you think it's just really because they really haven't done their homework?
That would be a big yes, sir. The people who propose and facilitate – okay, remember, I'm a math and science teacher, okay?
Right.
I work in numbers. if I wasn't in a serious talk with you, I could also tell you some pretty funny stuff. I really live quite a humorous life. In fact, my wife is so humorous, she could really debate with Phyllis Diller, and the both of them would come up laughing. So anyway, I have a funny life, even though I talk about a lot of serious stuff. And so with that question, it's going to be a numbers game. And everybody that proposes more immigration, you know, I'll give you this example. In 2013, I went into my U.S. senator's office here in Denver, Colorado, and showed him the graphs of what it's going to look like to add 138 million more people in the next 30 years. And I said, you got to reduce all immigration to less than 100,000 per year if we hope to survive the 21st century as an intact civilization. And I gave the numbers, and I gave the facts, I gave the graphs, I gave the 7 or 8 books on sustainability, and I literally spent 45 minutes, like I do at the colleges, and I have a slideshow that shows exactly where we're headed. And honest to gosh, U.S. Senator Michael Bennett didn't, in his Senate 744 bill, which was the Gang of Eight, and this bill promised to give amnesty to all these 20 to 30 million people, he didn't reduce the immigration, the legal immigration, down to 100,000 per year. He doubled it from the 1.2 million to 2 million. He doubled it to 2 million per year. You know, and I sat there, and I remember it was a Nancy Harrigan, and then there was a African American and also Hispanic American were, you know, the ones that watched the program. I gave them each all of the list of books to read. I gave them all the graphs. I gave them a cliff notes on what I was talking about. And I said, this is going to affect your children. And I said, it's going to create an unsustainable society. And water shortages and energy crisis and environmental, you name it. I named it all for them. Honest to gosh, I called her up. I said, weren't you listening? She says, well, yours wasn't the only opinion. And I said, that's the reason you doubled, you know, immigration to 2 million? And I said, with the fact that the third world keeps adding 80 million net gain new babies every year? And she says, well... And I said, how did somebody else come in here and tell you to get it up to 2 million? And she says, well, Mr. Bennett's going to stick with that number, and we hope to get this bill passed. Well, it passed the Senate and didn't pass the House. And I said, you condemned your children. I said, and mine wasn't opinion. Mine was scientific fact. And she literally just couldn't deal with it. Well, all of those people out there in the United States right now that are proposing, whether they're Christian groups that want to import, like the Lutherans want to import all the people of the world, the Catholic Church wants to import all these people, they don't understand that there are 80 million more new babies added net gain to the planet every year, 1 billion every 12 years. Another 3 billion by 2050, which is 33 years from now. And so because they don't realize that they're going to be, and their children are going to be, in the middle of a nightmare, which you can't get out of if you don't stop it before it occurs. And that's why I'm on your show tonight, and that's why I'm enlisting any and all Americans who have enough understanding of what we're facing to actually make changes and to take action, and I'll give you all of the information to help do that in part four of this series on the perfect storm descending upon America.
You know, one of the areas I've done a little research in, I'm not sure if you've done research in this area or not, but one of the things I've found is that the forests moderate the weather, and that
correct.
They, I mean,
and the oceans.
As we destroy our forests with the massive influx of population, I think we're seeing more and more extreme weather. So I think the overpopulation is causing an imbalance in the whole ecosystem and the planet.
Well, that's correct. And let me follow up on that, Mark. And every person listening, I want you to understand this. You can go and check all of my work. I am a journalist, an investigative research journalist. I've worked with top scientists in Antarctica. I wrote a book about it, Antarctica, An Extreme Encounter. I've seen the weather models. And here is just a small taste of what we can expect in this country in the next 10 to 20 years. And you're exactly correct. Whether it's Hurricane Katrina, or whether it's Sandy, or whether it's high-end typhoon, and you see all these tornadoes that are happening in the middle of Ohio in January, and so forth and so on, when a new person, like an Ethiopian, it goes from Ethiopia, they live over there, their ecological footprint is 0.4 acres, 0.4 of an acre. They can survive on it, they have their outhouse, they have their little hut, they do their thing. But as soon as an Ethiopian moves into the United States, and Ethiopia keeps overpopulating like just it's hell-bent for no ending, then that Ethiopian comes over to the United States. As soon as it gets here, he or she gets here, each single Ethiopian jumps from an ecological footprint of 0.4 acres to 25.4 acres here in the United States. So when you have that person hit here, they now are taking up and having to destroy 25.4 acres in housing and in track malls and in schools and roads, and then acreage to feed them that has to be destroyed and put into farmland, arable land. And if you take 100 million new immigrants added to the United States in the next 33 years, actually it's less than that, it's probably around 28 to 30, that means 2.54 billion acres of trees and forests and wilderness have to be destroyed in order to incorporate that 100 million people. Now, for those of you who are out there, you know, do your math. How would you like to see 2.54 billion more acres of woodlands here in the United States to be destroyed in order to create more, you know, crop land and so forth and so on, when we're already at the end of that particular rope as it is, and think we're going to survive this thing? Now, the second part of that is this. We burn 94 million barrels of oil every day worldwide, 94 million barrels of oil. And we burn, in this country, about 3 billion tons of coal. And then, of course, you've got natural gas. Well, guess what? All that carbon dioxide, it's called the carbon footprint, gets pumped up into the air, but guess where it goes? It goes into the oceans and it gets absorbed by the oceans. And when you warm the oceans and you also acidify them, you make them chemically imbalanced. And so as that chemical imbalance, you start to destroy the phytoplankton. Well, phytoplankton create 80% of the oxygen on this earth that we breathe. And as we destroy the oceans by acidifying them with all of this carbon, we then start wrecking the ecosystems. And as we warm the waters, then you have the cold air matching up with the warm air of the oceans that's out of balance, out of kilter. Voila! You get Hurricane Katrina. You get Hurricane Sandy. You get these hurricanes ripping across Cuba, tearing up all of St. Martin, and you name it. It is going to be a tornado, a typhoon, hurricane playground as we imbalance the biosphere further and further with this massive population loading, and certainly bringing in literally unending millions of immigrants in the United States, where the impact is just horrific on the biosphere itself and the weather patterns. And then the part three of this is, and I've been in the Amazon. In the Amazon, they're burning down at least 1 acre a minute.
Jeez.
I think it's an acre a minute. 1 acre a minute. You look it up. And in fact, it could. And so, if you think about it, we're burning down and tearing up almost the size of Ohio every year in the Amazon, and we're losing 100 species per day. And that's according to the Norman Myers, Oxford University, 35-year study, and I've heard him personally at the Gamma series here at the University of Colorado in Boulder. And so we're killing off all those species and really imbalancing. And does anybody know what rainforests grow on? Well, in South America, they grow on sand dunes. And it took millions of years. Sand dunes.
That's a huge statement. I had no idea. Goodness.
And guess what? It takes millennia to grow those encroaching those rainforests on the sand dunes. And so when you cut down the rainforest, it's only one or two feet of topsoil. And once the topsoil is gone, then you're back down to the – and so all of a sudden you've lost the stabilizing weather conditions that come in from the rainforest that stabilize all of the planet's biospheric weather patterns. So when you get to know all this stuff, and it's in my book, you just sit there and you go, oh, my gosh, we're in trouble.
That is a very important statement that you just made. I had no idea that the Amazon jungle
most people don't.
Was built on top of sand dunes.
Sand dunes, that's correct.
Could there have been an Amazon-like jungle in other areas, like in the area of Egypt and that part of the world at one time?
Absolutely.
I wonder if
I wonder if
these desert areas may have been gorgeous at one time.
Oh yeah, this is an amazing planet. Many of you, if you've studied your archaeology, if you've studied your biology, if you've studied your zoology, we've gone through five extinction sessions in the last 100 million years. We're now, of course, in the sixth extinction session, and it's not one coming on by an ice age. It's not one coming by a meteor that created a nuclear winter. This one is the sixth extinction session is now being caused by humanity overwhelming the animal world. Look it up, sixth extinction session, and it will show you all what's happening. When I was in Antarctica, I remember it was called Gondwana Land, okay? Gondwana Land, at one time, Africa was attached to South America, which was also attached to Antarctica. And as the tectonic plates split and broke up over the millions of years, I mean, for anybody that doesn't know this, Utah used to be under the Pacific Ocean. So it's amazing what this planet's doing. And so anyway, Gondwana Land was this massive Africa, South America, and even Antarctica and India. India broke off from that part of of Gondwana land. And in fact, India broke off from part of Australia, and then it shifted all the way across the Indian Ocean from Gondwana land and smashed into the Asian continent, and that's what created the 29,035-foot Chumalunga. That's of course Mount Everest. That's the mother Earth mother. That's the name of it by the Indians there. But South America then of course broke off from Africa, and then all of Antarctica, which is the highest continent in the world. It has an average altitude of 7,000 feet. It broke off and then slipped down into the South Pole. And so it's amazing how extraordinary this planet is. And yes, in so many different areas have been rainforests on deserts, and now the deserts are reclaiming so much of the verdant land that once was because of the changing climactic patterns. So yeah, it's very much dynamic. You know, in the end, if the human race survives the 21st century, which is questionable at this point, but if it doesn't, the universe won't even give a burp, and the Earth itself will start to heal. It'll neutralize all of the chemicals, the 70,000 chemicals that we've been pouring into it 24/7 for the last 100 years. It will regrow all of its forests. It will come into balance. For those of you who have an appreciation for the Gaia concept, that the Earth is a living, breathing, inspiring, and evolving planet filled with life, and the Gaia concept says that the water and the fire and the energy and the rain and the rocks and the sand and the soil, all of it creates this living planet. And we are so blessed to be a part of it at this point in time. But as you know, if you're looking at any of the unbelievable environmental impact of humanity on the planet, we're destroying it at the same time right now in the 21st century.
Some archaeologists say that there was a gigantic catastrophe about 12,000 years ago that wiped out a huge amount of the population. Have you ever studied that? It's a bit off topic, but thought I'd ask.
I haven't studied that one. Of course, you know, it was the meteorite that hit and then turned into a meteor that hit and became a meteorite that caused the nuclear winter that killed off all the dinosaurs, and that was 65 million years ago. There's been, I think, two or three ice ages that, you know, created the first five extinction sessions. So if there's been one 12,000 years ago, it could have killed off any number. I know that the meteor that hit killed off about 97% of all life on the planet because all the green things no longer grew, so everything couldn't function. But out of that 3% that didn't die off sprang what we have here now, and then sprang the human race that evolved out of that. So, and there's been many different kinds of hits over the years. So one 12,000 years ago, but I haven't studied that one, so that very well could have happened, and it killed off whatever numbers of species in the arena that where it hit.
You know, just listening to you speak made me think that education really is the hope for the Earth. It's really just a matter of education.
That's correct. It's all about education. That's why I've been on 1,500 radio shows in the last 20 years. I am attempting. I know, blows me away too. I really care about humanity and all the plants and animals on the planet. We've been gifted with such a wondrous globe, and this is such a wondrous opportunity. I'm 70 years old, and I've had an extraordinary life. And in fact, my next book is coming out in March, How to Live a Spectacular Life. And I would like to pass on to all of humanity, Americans, and of every race, creed, and color, and all of the globe, and all of the animals of the globe, the opportunity to survive and thrive through the 21st century. Because this is such a magical existence, and we all get maybe 80 years, 70 to 80 years, if we take care of ourselves. So I'd like to really pass that on. And my heroes are like John Muir and Susan B. Anthony and Dr. Martin Luther King and Eleanor Roosevelt and Jane Goodall. They all cared enough to do something to make the future better for all of us. And so that's why I really have dedicated myself to bring this population immigration thing to the forefront of the American people and all the colleges that I visit, and hopefully create a consciousness shift and then a critical mass shift where we take action and finally a tipping point toward a viable and thriving civilization in the 21st century, not only here in the United States, but all over the planet. It behooves us to help future generations to live on a viable planet.
I remember in your article you talked about Dearborn, Michigan, mm-hmm. and the tremendous number of immigrants they have there. Can you tell us about that?
As a matter of fact, I can. I am an old Michigan farm boy. I grew up in a small farming community north of Grand Rapids, south of Cadillac, and still have an 80-acre farm there. And I got to grow up with the chickens and the cows, and I helped watch everything get born, and I saw animals die. My grandpa used to cut the heads off of chickens, and then we'd pluck the feathers, throw it in the pot, and the whole darn thing. And Detroit, at one time, was 1.85 million people. 1.85 million people. I forget what size it was. It was like third, fourth, or largest, whatever city in the United States. Well, today, and I wrote a piece that's been quite famous. It's called The Tragedy of Detroit, because in the summers from my math and science teaching job, I was a long-haul trucker for United Van Lines. In fact, Corrigan Moving Systems right out of Dearborn. I knew Dearborn like the back of my hand. I traveled there, did everything there, moved people. I was one of the van drivers to literally move a million people out of Detroit. And in fact, the whole city collapsed through the 90s. And it collapsed because of sociological incompatibility and literally a million European Americans fled Detroit. Coleman Young was African American, corrupt beyond. He made Stalin look like a saint.
Wow.
He was so corrupt, and he didn't kill so many people, but he created so much havoc that the European Americans just fled the city. And then finally, when I wrote the article, it was left at, well, only 912,000 people left. And then now it's down to 648,000, and about 350,000 of that is now Arabic immigrants. And Dearborn, right now, Dearborn, I just was there just 2 months ago. Dearborn, Michigan is now a Muslim caliphate. It has completely changed. Everything is worm writing, and you know what worm writing is? It's Arabic. It looks like worm writing. It looks like worms. And so they call it worm writing, and they have run anybody that's left in Dearborn has got mosques that are just like, they're like forts. They're like territorial markers, and there's no American flags there. Arabic is spoken. The schools are now literally in Arabic. All your telephone calls are all in Arabic. And you see women wearing the black covering burqas with the little eyelets, and it's madrasas everywhere. Dearbornistan is now called. I think you saw in that 10-minute flick that I have in that article by Dennis Lynch, that Dearborn, Michigan, is no longer an American city. It's a Muslim caliphate, and it's going to get even worse. And amazingly enough, virtually all of them are on welfare. And there's honor killings there now. There's female genital mutilation going on of the women. There's certainly arranged marriages. Ann Curry at NBC News did a story on that. And you also have gays are not safe in Dearborn, Michigan anymore because it has a Muslim dominance. And in fact, when I was there in November, there was an honor killing just south of Dearborn in Rocky was Rocky River, Ohio. Father shot his daughter for wearing jeans in her sleep with not just one shot to the head, but two shots to the head. I actually have that article. Yeah, so that's what we have coming in the United States. So that the perfect storm, the first part is the numbers, but the sociological impact is going to be even worse than anybody can appreciate because whether you heard about or saw the Berlin Germany, running all these people down and killing them, or you looked at just a week ago, Fort Lauderdale, here comes a Muslim, Ashid Hamad, or whatever his name was, Ashik Hamad. He just shot five people and shot another eight that lived, but that's the mandate of the Quran, and that's what it does, and that's what they do. And whether you call it Lone Wolf or you call it Paris, France, where they had 10 or 20 of them, that's what they do, and that's what we're importing into this country. And you can bet, I'll tell you right this right now, Mark, somebody, an American citizen or family or a whole bunch of us, are going to be the next Fort Lauderdale or the next Orlando or the next San Bernardino. There's going to be another terrorist attack by somebody we imported into this country from an Arabic land, from a Muslim country, because that's what they do. And that's chilling, because somebody listening tonight might be one of the victims of that next terrorist attack, because it's going to happen. It's coming as surely as the dawn.
So when you're in Dearborn, Michigan, do you see the signs are now in Arabic?
Oh, yeah. I've got pictures of them. Yeah. Virtually
amazing.
All, you go down Joy Road, you can go down Telegraph, you can go down Ford Road. I went down all these roads. I used to drive the big 18-wheeler. For United Van Lines, and it's everything is in Arabic. And in fact, they had to all of the councils that are left, like Hamtramck, everything was in Arabic, so much so that they had to pass a law to get some kind of English writing, because nobody knew where a fire was. They couldn't bring in the police because everything was in Arabic. So they've now passed the law where you have to also have some numbers, in English numbers, so that they can actually find where the fire is or the crime is or the wife abuse or whatever when somebody calls up. Yeah, I'm telling you, Dearborn, Michigan's a completely it's a little Baghdad here in the United States of America. I saw it firsthand.
It stuns me. I'm just stunned by that. So you're saying the Muslim immigrants, they really do not want to assimilate into American culture, then?
No, they do not, and they will not, and they cannot. It's against everything that the Quran talks about. I've read most of the Quran, and I mean, it's pretty frightening. It literally provokes violence in all of its readers at any point in time to chop people's heads off and cut off their fingertips and create terror so that they can create what is called hijra. Hijra is ceding host countries to spread the Islamic caliphate, which then spreads Sharia law. And for those of you who know what Sharia law is, it is the most barbaric, godforsaken kind of political, economic, and religious law, because anybody who opposes it is immediately killed. And I always find it amazing on Facebook when I see all these lesbian, gay, transgender groups celebrating and let's go against Islamophobia, when in fact Islamic countries kill gays. They toss them right off of buildings. They chop their heads off. Anyone that's this gay literally should be terrified of being having a country turn or any area turn into an Islamic caliphate, because their lives will be in danger.
Have you ever had the opportunity to debate anyone that's pro-immigration?
You know, I have. I've actually Aaron Arbor out here in Denver is asking me to come talk about the pro immigration population stance, and I'm hoping to get on PBS here. I've tried to get on his show for the last 15 years. Also, Mark, I've tried to get on 60 Minutes. I have written all the producers and all the directors and all of the hosts, Leslie Stahl, Steve Croft, Scott Pelley, all of them. I've posted. Any of you see me, I've tried to get on Meet the Press, Face the Nation. But I got to tell you, there's extraordinary powers that be, if you will, that absolutely push as hard and have so much money to absolutely destroy any conversation on immigration and overpopulation here in the United States. It has been an exasperation for me, because if you get me into any kind of a debate, I will factually bury any host or anybody with facts that this is not sustainable. And probably that's why they don't want to have me on 60 Minutes, because there's no way you could argue for another 138 million more people in this country by 2050. And you sure as heck didn't want to argue for another 325 million past that, because that's where we're headed. Before the next 80 years is up, at the current rate of immigration and the children born of immigrants and their chain migrated relatives, we're going to have 625 million more people in this country. And if you don't think I'm giving you the facts, just go to numbersusa.org and just take the five-minute video by Roy Beck called Immigration, Gumballs, and Poverty. And then the second one is a 10-minute video, which is called Immigration Off the Charts. And that's the final result of mass immigration. And I'll tell you what, if all of Americans would see those two videos here in the next month, there would be a national clamor to stop all immigration into the United States. Because here's the fact. The American woman has been averaging 2.03 children since 1970. And that stems from birth control and the 1970, when I was in college, Earth Day. And back then we only had 3.5 billion on the planet. And so all of these European countries, Canada, Europe, Australia, New Zealand, all started having only two children. But guess what? The third world kept having 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 kids, and they steamed ahead and added 3.8 billion, and we now have 7.3 billion on the planet because of that. I know these numbers just absolutely should be shocking you and blowing your mind, and you're sitting there going, oh, my God, this man knows what he's talking about. And you're right. I'm a math science teacher, and I've seen it personally. As a matter of fact, people ask me how I got to care so much about this. Well, I was a happy-go-lucky kid teaching math and science, and back in 1984, I bicycled from Hong Kong all the way to Beijing and the Ming dynasties and the Wall of China. In fact, I looked right in back of me, and I got a picture of me on the Wall of China. One of my greatest moments. And I said, oh, my gosh, we got a problem. And the problem is there were 1.3 billion people in China, and they were stacked on top of each other. The Yangtze River was a giant cesspool sewer pipe leading out into the ocean, creating a 20,000-square-mile dead zone. Well, I've been on the Ganges, and that's the same thing. It's so filthy, nobody can drink it, no industrial use, no animal, livestock. It's just a nightmare, and it's poisoning the oceans. And that's when I started writing about it back after 1984, because I saw it firsthand. In India, India is a total nightmare. It's hopeless. And, in fact, I just did a story. You can go to many of the news sites, like newswithviews.com, look it up. I called the deadliest birth rate for all humanity. Number part one was Africa. Part two was India. Part three was China. And then part four was the recipient nations of the deadliest birth rate. For those of you who don't understand how enormous this thing is, Africa today is 1.1 billion Africans. By 2050, at the current birth rates, they will be 2 billion Africans. And by the end of the century, which is, what, 80-something, 83 years from now, there will be 4 billion Africans. So if you think that that stream of miserable and suffering and refugees is going to end, that's streaming into Europe right now or streaming into our country at 1.5 to 1.7 million annually, that number is going to increase. In fact, the United Nations, Mark, has said that there's going to be over 50 million refugees in the next 10 years or less.
It's incredible.
Oh, it's astonishing. Folks, you can look up every single number I'm talking to you and talking with you and sharing with you, and you will see that it is totally substantiated. U.S. Census Bureau, Fogel Martin U.S. Population Projections, the Pew Research Center. I'm not kidding you. This stuff's coming at us like a brakeless freight train.
And, you know, there are
still
people.
It's a whirlwind Katrina.
There are still people that argue against overpopulation, though. It's amazing.
Oh, yeah. As a matter of fact, what they are called, Dr. Albert Bartlett said it in his works. You can all go to www.lbartlett.org. He just said they're called enumerates. And enumerates are mathematically illiterate. I rest my case.
You know, sometimes
they just don't know.
Yeah, sometimes people, they look at it from a wrong perspective. They look at it just from the square miles of surface on the earth, and they think, oh, all we got to do is spread out. Of course, it's crazy. It just not that simple. I mean, there's 6.5 million square miles on Antarctica, and people aren't going to live down there. They're going to move to the places where there's water and where the climate's good and where there's forest, and that's what's happened. We get these mega cities, and you know, people just need to start looking at things differently.
That's correct. As a former resident of Antarctica, it's actually 7.4 million square miles, and there's not single tree. Yeah. Oh yeah, 7.4. There's not one. You know, of course, it depends on the mass of the winter. It doubles in size and so forth. But it has a 7.4 million square miles, and not one single tree. It has nothing to do with how much land there is. It has to do with carrying capacity. You know, Nobel laureate Dr. Henry J. W. Kendall said this, and I quote, "If we don't halt population growth with justice and compassion, it will be done for us by nature, brutally and without pity, and we'll leave a ravaged world," unquote. There's another 100 top scientists that have made very similar quotes. In fact, E.O. Wilson, the Harvard biologist who's still alive, said, and he says we're going to lose a third of all species within the next 30 years on the planet. And he said the raging monster upon the land is population growth. In its presence, sustainability is but a fragile theoretical construct. To say, as many people do, that the difficulties of nations are not due to people but to poor ideology and land use management is sophistic, unquote. Yippee-ki-yo-ki-ray. And here's another one. I think most people, these are the top experts. The Green Revolution was instigated as a result of the efforts, of course, you know, Norman Borlaug, who, while accepting the Nobel Peace Prize in 1970, said, and I quote, "The Green Revolution has won a temporary success in man's war against hunger and deprivation. It has given man a breathing space. If fully implemented, the revolution can provide sufficient food for the sustenance during the next three decades. But the frightening power of human reproduction must also be curbed. Otherwise, the success of the Green Revolution will be ephemeral only," unquote. Takes your breath away, doesn't it?
Now, if we let population on this planet get too high, there will be some kind of disaster that will come that will drastically reduce our population in a very short time. Isn't that correct? That's what I've heard.
That's exactly correct. And I would say this to every person listening. We're going to run out of oil that drives all of these major, you know, there's 20 million down there in Mexico City. What keeps them fed? How about the 8.3 million in New York City or the 11 million in the Los Angeles basin? What keeps them fed? Gasoline. And that gasoline is going to be gone sometime in this century, and it's going to be really hard to get to. And there's nothing on the horizon to replace it. And how are you going to feed 10 billion people? And as a matter of fact, Walter Youngquist, one of the top experts in the world on energy, he said, and I quote, "As we go from this happy hydrocarbon bubble, we have reached now to a renewable energy resource economy, which we must do in this century. Will the civil part of civilization survive? As we both know, there's no way that alternative energy sources can supply the amount of per capita energy we enjoy now, not much less than the 10 billion expected by 2050. And energy is what keeps this game going. We are involved in a Faustian bargain, selling our economic souls for the luxury of the life, luxurious life of the moment, but sooner or later the price has to be paid," unquote. I mean, there are so many quotes like this that you just sit here and you go, this guy knows what he's talking about. You know, and just to give you a little addition, the 94 million barrels of oil that are burned every day around the world, that's 42 gallons to the barrel. And to give you an idea, if you take 94 million barrels of oil and you put each barrel side by side, that's 20 inches per barrel, that would create a belt that would go well over 25,000 miles around the equator. And we fill up that belt of oil every 12 o'clock and start burning it at 12:01, and burn it down, and you can imagine all the carbon, of course. And that's going to change because in right now, according to Howard Kunstler in the Long Emergency, China adding 27 million new cars every year, and they've got 50 lanes of traffic going one way. 50 lanes.
What?
I've been to China. Let me tell you. Yeah,
50.
Yeah. Look, just
50.
Yeah. Look.
No.
Go to YouTube. Oh, I know. You sit here and you go, 20 would be out of my league. Well,
yeah.
They expect to be burning. They expect to be burning 98 million barrels of oil every single day by 2030, according to Howard Kunstler's book, The Long Emergency. So somewhere in the next 13 years, the human race is going to be burning almost 200 million barrels of oil every day. Can you imagine? I'm telling you, we are coming to a rendezvous, and like you said, there's going to be massive human die-off along with the animal die-off when we can't feed this human herd of 10 billion people. And yet, there are unbelievable moneyed corporate elites, power sources here in the United States that will keep all of this information away from the American people.
Oh, yeah.
And they're
doing it
very successfully. Yeah, very successfully.
I just want to get – I want to hear this again just so I can absorb it. You said 50 lanes of traffic in China?
Yeah. Go to YouTube. Okay. Now, if I'm wrong, chastise me all you want. But I actually saw – I saw the pictures of it. Unless somebody created a giant scenario, a false picture or a false thing – 50 lanes of traffic one way. China now boasts the longest traffic jams, 120-mile traffic jams, where they actually have to go in and take helicopters to bring people food and to bring them gasoline to finally, because they can't peel off enough. They got to bring them water. 120-mile long traffic jams.
Oh my Lord.
Go to Google right now and just Google it, the longest traffic jam in the world, and it'll come up. That China has now the longest traffic jams, and the last one that I read was 120 miles long.
That's just stunning. So what we're going to see then, I guess, is extreme weather, water shortages, growing deserts, and starvation.
Yep.
Amazing.
Right. Yeah, that's what you're going to see.
It's stunning. Frosty, I always love talking to you. Thanks for coming on the show. Why don't you tell the listeners about your website, your books, and any other things you got going on?
You know, my fun website is howtolivealifeofadventure.com. And in that website, I post every week some fun stories, and I write a lot of fun vignettes, and that's beautiful. What I would really enjoy or really encourage each of you is to get on numbersusa.org and download the 5-minute video called Immigration, Gumballs, and Poverty, and then also the 10-minute one that's Immigration Off the Charts, and show those everywhere. I would also ask you to go to capsweb.org, capsweb.org, California's for Population Stabilization with Joanne Weidman, and become a member. Join these organizations. They've got over 7, almost 8 million people right now so that you have a voice. There's also carryingcapacitynetwork.org with David Durham. Give yourself a voice. We have got, get Frosty Wooldridge onto 60 Minutes. Write a letter to 60 Minutes at 60M, as in minutes, at cbsnews.com. Beg, borrow, steal, and ask Leslie Stahl, ask Scott Pelley, ask Steve Croft, all of them, to interview Frosty Wooldridge or interview another 35 top skill.org with Dr. Jack Alpert. He's brilliant, and I've been working with him for over 15 years. He's got 4 videos that will say the same thing I'm saying to you right now in words. He's got them in pictures. So if you do that, we can change the course of history. We can change the future of our civilization toward a viable and a thriving future for our children. And if you can do that, and you can write me at frostyw@juno.com, I will answer any question. And we can, again, consciousness shift, which you've just had tonight, critical mass shift, by taking action, tipping point, moving forward to the positive choice to create a positive future for our children and all the animals on this planet. I want an international, national debate, discussion on immigration and overpopulation so that we can do something. Because right now, nobody is talking about this. Anything that you've heard tonight is being squashed by the mainstream press, and they will continue to squash it unless you, the individual American, jumps out of your seat, takes action. And I always leave with this: never think that you can do so little that you do nothing at all. Let's do this together, folks, each and every one of you, and start a national discussion on overpopulation here in the United States, driven by mass immigration that is futile because the third world adds 80 million new babies net gain every year, so the line doesn't only not end, it increases by 80 million net gain every year. Well, I can't wait to come back on again, Mark. It's been a pleasure and an honor, and hopefully everybody is literally sweating and also get the towel out, but also get on your computer and start writing letters, and we can change the future by our actions today.
Thanks, Frosty. Have a great evening, sir. Bye-bye.
Every day is a beautiful day.